Right, hello everyone. YouTube, everybody. Hope everybody's staying safe. I am, I'm in my shed. Antennas. Amateur radio antennas. I always fancied a screwdriver antenna, but God, they're stupidly expensive. So I've looked at some designs, and the best one, obviously, Don Williams from America, unfortunately passed away, but fantastic design. I think they're now Scorpion antennas. So I thought, well, I can build one of them. Yeah, I can, but anyway, if you ever want an antenna to build, to pull your hair out, this is the one. So, and I advise you to steer clear of 80 metres, unless you've really got long hair. So, anyway, this is what I've done. Right. This basically is just thin wall, 2-inch aluminium tube. It's a tiny bit over 2-inch. It's the sort of tube that you get when you put a big TV antenna up. They normally supply that type. It's slightly bigger than a scaffold tube, but very thin wall compared to scaffold tube. So originally I started with about 4.5 foot length, and the coil I had a piece of about 3.5 foot of 1.5 inch tubing, which I put in the lathe, and because you can't really put proper threads in fiberglass, it all tears apart. I used a Dremel just to score the threads, which would give me an idea where to put the wire, but that worked out at 8 threads an inch. Don't do 8 threads an inch, do it 10, because it changes the changes the effect of the antenna, which I found out. I could almost get resonant 80 meters, but that had to be completely out of the 4.5 inch tube, 4.5 feet tube, plus a 9 foot whip on the top, which when you consider that's got to go on a vehicle, nah, forget it. It's not gonna do it. So I've got an 80 meter antenna on my van, which is perfectly resonant. It's a Pro-Am antenna, single band, and I'm gonna leave that on there now. And I've got lots of other Pro-Am antennas for all the other bands, but I don't wanna keep getting out swapping antennas. So what I've done is I've done this. Basically I halved the piece of tube that I'd got, and started again. In actual fact, that's the only thing I've bought. Everything else I had, pieces of tube, steel whips, so on. I bought, I can't even remember what length that is. Hang on a minute. I'll give you some dimensions, save you asking. That is a 16 inch piece of nylon rod. 2 inch in diameter, 50 mil. Which I machined down to, I think it was 47 mil, so it'd go inside the tube easily with the wire on it. The wire is just 1.5 mil single core earth cable. You can get it at Screwfix. I think it's about 15-16 quid for 100 meters. Now you need 75 feet of wire at, and that I machine that on the lathe, just put a groove in it, 10 turns per inch, 10 threads per inch, and you need 75 feet of that. Don't put a metal or aluminium spacer in there to lock it off with, because it'll affect the antenna. I've got a brass bit there just for the threaded bar. In the top it doesn't matter, because that's going to be connected anyway. That's screwed together in three places. That's where your antenna fits on your thing. Right, I've used stainless steel rod, and altogether that's about 20 inches machined on the end with a hex to fit the screwdriver. these springs and lock washers, if you look, I've grooved out some of the thread. And what that does, when you get to the top or the bottom, I've done a piece, done one on the top as well. When you get to the top or the bottom, instead of ruining your thread and mangle everything in up, that this threaded part comes to that no thread and just spins, so it can't go anywhere, so you know it's at the bottom. And when you turn it back the other way, the spring helps it push the antenna back onto the threads. And again, it does the same at the end. It's just like a spring clutch, so stops it messing things up. So that's that. Cheap screwdriver antenna. This one's a 6 volt. Piece of nylon again, machined. The center of the coax, which will come off the PL259. Again, this is got a PL259 fitting. The center of the coax here will go onto that, and that is soldered through there onto a piece of brass, which connects to the aluminium tube when it's all together. So that becomes your earth when it's connected to your vehicle. Your coax earth goes to that and your vehicle, and the live comes up here to this. So your tube, the whole of the tube, is part of the antenna. Okay? Now, the very top where it connects here, what I've done is I've machined this. It's a little bit big, but it's because I used, I'll explain why in a minute, but that fits on the top there. Like that. And then screws in to the tube to hold it tight. These are just holes, three holes at 120 degrees with a piece of stainless steel plate so it don't rust. Stainless steel screws all over. Now what that does, I messed about with all sorts of ideas for the fingers to touch the antenna wire, the loading coil. I tried copper fingers, and I just wasn't happy with it. As soon as they bent, I tried brass. The brass was too flimsy. I believe what you need is I forgot the damn word for it now. It's like a springy copper, beryllium, that's it. If you can find some, brilliant. I couldn't find any. You can get it off eBay or the internet, but it's bloody expensive and you have to buy it in fairly large quantities, so not worth it. So on the internet, I was watching all about these antennas, and I happened to come across the small Yaesu Atus antenna, and their way of touching the springs, granted they use six, was ball bearings on springs. Well, they used a little sprung piece of metal plate, same idea. So I stole the idea from them. So I've got ideas from everybody, so thank you to everybody who's given me ideas. Now, under normal circumstances, you need a fairly long whip, 8-9 foot. But what I found, 50 megs, you only need a whip of about a foot and a half, because you're using the whole of the antenna. So the whole, including this tube, which becomes resonant, so you've only got that as a resonant length, which works great. You can keep it like that. You can then tune 10. This will go down to 40 meters, no problem at all, absolutely no problem, and it only comes out about halfway. 80 meters, it will get close to 80 meters if you've got one hell of a massive whip on the top, but I'm not going to worry about that. So if you want, you can just use, you know, a foot and a half of steel whip, and that will give you 6 through 40 metres. 40 metres is a little bit dodgy. It does like a slightly longer whip, so I'll stick with that. So anyway, so that's all the thing. Right, between the live connection and earth, you need a coil. It's called a shunt coil. Without it, you will struggle. Don't ask me why, I don't really understand the ins and outs of capacitance and inductance and everything. I tried lots of different variations. This is 2mm enameled wire with 8 turns. And that connects between there, the live, and there, which is the earth. And it just sits on the outside. So that live is going down the inside to that PL259. I'll put it all together and show you how it all goes together. So, right, we'll get to that and I'll get set up and I'll be back in a second. Right, I have to remember to put it in together in the correct order as well, otherwise you end up pulling it all apart again thinking, oh bugger. So to start with, we'll pass, oh, I forgot to mention about the ferrites. You need the ferrites on the drive for the motor because it affects, again, everything affects it. It's a pain in the bum. Right, I'll mark these with a dimple so I know where they all fit together. And then the cable, that pushes in like that. And then we get some where's that gone? Come here. Trouble is if you use too long a bit, again that affects it, so let's just clip that onto there and pull that through there, that's better. Right. That goes on there. Then we put some screws in. These are just little self-tapping screws which screw into the nylon really well. So, and I've got 4 around it. They ain't going anywhere when they're in. Right. The reason I didn't video it everything from the beginning is because I kept changing my mind on what I was doing, and that would have been just a pain because I'd have been forever deleting video and swapping round and changing. So I just thought I'd wait till the end and show you the video. Right, that goes in there, that goes in there. We have some solder. And we solder that back onto there. God, I must replace the tip of my soldering iron, it's getting right manky. Okay, now that'll go in there. These are all stainless steel screws, by the way, so hopefully we won't have any rusting issues. Now what I have seen, I'm using a PL25, an SO239. You don't have to use that. Which is one of the ways I was going to do it originally. And that is, I'll show you. I some use a quite a large chunk of coax. I better change the battery. Right, I'll be back in a second. Right, sorry. Piece of RG213 or Westflex or whatever. That's what I've used here. Pigtailed the centre core and then wrapped a small piece of copper around the braid. And that went from earth there to the live point there. So you could have that on the outside if you wanted to. The only reason I decided not to was because if some bright spark comes up and chops it, cuts it or does what, you got to make another one of those. Whereas if somebody cuts your coax, you just got to put another plug on. So that's why I did it that way. Because you know what these bright sparks are like. They do things for, well, for reasons beyond, well, I shan't go into that, otherwise I'll be here forever. I will probably, when it's all, I know it's all perfect and there's no issues, I will put Loctite on all these screws so they can't vibrate loose, but for now, I shall leave that alone. And as for the end, it's just a small thin piece of aluminium, it's about 10mm I think or something, machined and then bolted into the bottom. Right, so that's that. Now the motor, I just cut the piece that would normally hold the battery for one of these little motors, I just cut it off because you don't need it. You will need to do some sort of resistance on the end of the cable that you drive it with, because these are only 6 volt, so you're going to have to thing. Now the screws on the front for this one actually go into the plastic and hold it in place, and also pull through there. Also, you must remember, this is where I've done it so many times, you've got to put the coil in here first, because inside this tube there's a piece of rubber that fits around this end and locks it in place. When it's all together, it locks it in place, but that coil won't go past that rubber, so it's got to come in from the from the top end. So that goes in there, sticks out the bottom, join there. I've got a split pin. Stick a split pin in it. Where's my pliers? Bend that up. Again, I've marked this so I know where everything goes. Oh dear, that battery's not going to... Oh, it is. All right, sorry. Can't see it in the light. Mark these. Right. So that now goes in there. Again, marked so they all connect to the right place. Butterfingers. Now the only thing I've got left to make is an actual mount for the van, to bolt it to the van. So that soldered connection in that little bit of brass now is having a really, really good connection to the tube. And when I've done it all, I'm going to wrap some amalgamating tape. Don't put insulating tape or heat shrink, because you will get damp in there and it will stay in there and rot everything. Use self-amalgamating tape because it's much better. And again, these screws, as they go in, they just go into the motor housing and hold everything in place, so the motor can't turn.
Okay. Move down a bit. Oh no, come back. I'm finished. Right, coil. Coil goes on here. Screw. Different type of screw just to hold that in place. And that's just an 8mm bolt pushed through the inside of the casing. Right, that's that. This bit of polythene, PTFE, whatever, I can't even remember, nylon, whatever it is. Now that goes on here. And what that's going to do, I'm going to make a clamp for the bottom, and then this will have a clamp around it with a bolt to clamp the top to give it stability. So don't forget to put one of them on, or whatever you want to use. Now there are two ways to do this bit. You can either take the screws out and put them all in one at a time, but what I've found, if you put that upright like that, put that over, put the springs in, put the springs in, and then push one of the ball bearings in. You can't see what I'm doing, I'm sorry, but it's a bit awkward to see, but I'll try and show you what I'm doing. You sort of need, you can't see from there, can you? Where can you see? Right, that might be just about right. Right. Oh, and I forgot to say, the coil comes through the nylon and solders to the tab there. Right. So now you just push in. You've got to do the three ball bearings all at the same time. So you sort of need three fingers. It's like one of those ball games, you know, on that thing. You have to get all the balls in the holes. Now if you just push that one in with that finger, come on. Probably is easier to do it the other way around, but one in that one. One in that one. And then just slide it down. Those delayed figures from the office personal statistics, and there we go, different from the daily updates we get. And then just do these screws up, grub screws, and that holds the top on tight. And the only thing I have now got to make is a cover. I was going to use some 3-inch black guttering, but unfortunately now with this it's too big, won't fit. So you just make a cap to fit under the screw there, and then the tubes go around the outside so that your coil isn't exposed when it's out on the road, so it's all covered up. So, and there you go, and then the whip goes in the top. Right, for now that's it, and I'll show you it working shortly when I get it all back together. I'd put a clamp on the bottom. The clamp I'm going to machine is something like that, so that will clamp around the base of the antenna, and then something here to go onto the vehicle, and then the other one will just have a bolt in it, long bolt or piece of wood, something to fit. I'm going to probably use the hinge bolts on the back of the van on the door, so I've got to machine that yet. So there you go. I'll show you it working in a little while. Cheers for now, I'll be back shortly.
Right, welcome back. I've just clamped this to a plate and to my tower that I haven't. I've got a. This is the one I did when I did that trailer, but this one wants galvanizing and then whatever, do whatever. Anyway, I've bolt clamped it to that, just put a little battery on it and an up and down switch. And I've got a very short whip on it, 14 inches, something like that, and that's almost fully down. So basically for 6 meters it's using this part of the aerial, the whole thing and the whip. And with that fully down, as you can see, will it look? I don't know if you can see it. Can you see it? That's about 2.9. Right, if I could go up a tiny bit, hopefully you can see this. Oh. Oh. That's hard to do with the other end. Right, 40, where are we at? I'll go up to 50. Bottom end of 50 metres. Up in it. Oh, no, there. Oh, there we go, 1.6 to 1. Just a little bit of jiggling up and down and you'll get it. Can be a bit tricky. Anyway, basically resonant there. And that's only a tiny bit out. Now that will do 10 meters as well. Right, we're on 1.6 to 1 now. So we go, this is a future check. No, it's not a copy of the MFJ-266. The MFJ-266 is this analyzer. All they do is they buy job lots of these in their thousands with blank faces, rebrand MFJ-266 on it and flog it for £3,500, where these are £1,500. So just by putting MFJ on it, they charge you £200 more. So don't be fooled. Don't buy one of them. Buy one of these. Anyway, let's go to 28. Where are we? 28, somewhere over the back there. 28.7. So we've got to go up a little bit. And hopefully. There you go, 1.5 to 1. As I say, twiddling up and down and you'll get it even closer, but there you go, 1 to 1. 28.500. 1.2, 1. So, bit of twiddling. Perfect, right, 15 meters. Well, let's go to 24, just in case people want to use 24. Was it 9? Yeah, about 9, 950. Try that. Oh, by the way, 10 metres. Only that much up. Personally, I'd use the big whip, but which I think I'll swap for. Let me just swap for the taller whip. Right, with the taller whip on, now we've got the tall whip on, that's that one about 4.5 foot tall. Right, go up a tiny bit more. I'm really hoping you can see that. It's difficult to see whether you can see the analyzer or not. I'm hoping you can. can't see. Oh. It's difficult for me to see in the camera face whether you can see the thing or not. Anyway, right, we'll go up a bit. Oh, in actual fact, might want to come down thinking about it, because I put the tall whip on it. There you go, 44. Should be around there somewhere. There it is. There you go. That's 1.2 to 1, 1 to 1. Yeah. Yeah, no problem. And that's, again, with the tall whip on, that's about where the 10 meter was. So we'll go to 15. No, that should be up. Down. Cool. 15. No, I'm going the wrong way. It's the only thing, these go opposite when you're on HF. Turning it clockwise makes it go down in frequency. Right, 15 meters. 21, go about halfway through the band to 200 something. There you go. And we'll go off a bit. If you watch these two, that's, I can't remember which is which, one's capacitance and one's reactance. And that's, is that inductance? Yeah, if, when those level out to 50, you get into 50 ohms. One's ohms, that's right, something like that. You can measure the inductance of an aerial on this as well. If you press down and power, it'll show the inductance in microhenries for each band. So just so you know. Right, where was I going? D, what am I doing? D. No, E. Cool. Get right in a minute. Come back down. Oh, come on. E. No, oh, it jumps. Why is it jumping? E. Right, there we go. 21. Get there in a minute. Right. There you go. Oh, just passed it. Yeah. It's very touchy. Oh, crikey, it's difficult to hold the switch and hold everything at the same time. Oh, there we go. 1.2 to 1, 1.3. That's difficult for you to see if you can see that. And we're that much up. So you don't have to be up much to get all the bands. Right, what we're going to go to now? 20 meters, which is C. No, D. What are we on? D, sorry, yeah, down, D, right, 20 metres. Line that up there. 13, 14, 14, 200-ish. And we'll go up. Oh, just spotted. 1.4, 1.3, 1.2, 1.2 to 1. Middle of the band.
And again, we're only that much up.
I think that that whip will do 40. Let me just try. Go to the C and go down to 40. 7 point, I'm going to go around 7177180. Alright, again, we'll go up. This should go up quite a way actually, because it's a big band, big long way away. That might want the taller Oh no. Oh, there we go. There we go, 1.4 to 1. Very, very touchy on 40. But a little bit of twiddling. And whichever part of the band you want to be in, you'll be alright.
And that's only that much up. With a very, very big whip, about 10 foot. And it all the way out, it does get close to 80, but I'm not bothered about 80 because I'm going to keep my other antenna on for the 80. So there you go. So all I've got to do now is find a cap to go over here, and I've just thought an old pop bottle or something will be perfect size for that. I mean, really, you could make that smaller, and I hadn't got smaller ball bearings, otherwise I'd have made that smaller. And use smaller springs and smaller ball bearings, so that wouldn't be so chunky, but it doesn't matter. Neither are in there. So then when that's fully down, that will be about there, fixed to the vehicle. So there you go. Hope that's been enlightening for you, and I hope other people get round to doing a similar project. And we'll try it out sometime in the mobile. So thanks for watching. Until the next project, see you later and stay safe.